Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wassalatu wassalam ala ashrafil mursalin sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd, my name is Ghania Sadiq Ashir, and here in the studio with me is our father in Islam, Alhaji Umar Sanda, an imam, a special duty, and the chief imam of special duty in Nigerian Air Force Base, Kaduna, till date. So he has been a lecturer, a teacher all his life, from Zaria Elementary School to Zaria Middle School and Bauchi Teacher College. So, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala nabiyyi al-akrami Sayyidina Muhammad al-Fatih al-Khatimi wa ala alihi haqqa qadrihi wa miqdarihi al-azim.
Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. The topic we're going to discuss this afternoon is piety. Who are the pious people? We're going to look at it from the Islamic point of view, from the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, that is chapter 2, from verse 2 to 5 of the Holy Quran, where after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alif Lam Mim. Dhalika al-kitab la rayba fihi hudan lil-muttaqin. Alladhina yu'minuna bil-ghaybi yuqimuna as-salata wa mimma razaqnahum yunfiqun. Walladhina yu'minuna bima unzila ilayka wa ma unzila min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Ulaika ala hudan min rabbihim wa ulaika humul muflihun. They are the pious, they are the pious, those people that believe in what is not, is unseen. That is Allah. We don't believe it. They cannot see Allah, but they believe in Allah. So our father in Islam is going to tell us more about piety. What is piety and what, how can we demonstrate the aspect of piety?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Piety is demonstrated physically, intellectually and spiritually. That's why when you come to do ablution or bath or other things, you do it thrice. Or prayers, you do it thrice. The first one represents the physical part of piety, the other one the intellectual part of it. The third one reflects the spiritual part of piety. The spiritual part of piety is, no, you must know that the Almighty Tabarak wa Ta'ala, who has sent the Sharia, always sees you. He always hears you. And all that you do, you have in your mind, he knows it very well. And if he has directed you to do anything, you do it in accordance with the Sharia. That is what his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught you, or what his representatives, the ulama, have taught you, exactly in accordance with the rules. For example, when you come to do your ablution, you face the Qibla. You face the Qibla first. You sit down with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then you seek refuge by the Almighty against our arch enemy, the real enemy of man, that is the devil. You say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi a'udhu bika min hamazati shayateen wa a'udhu bika rabbi an yahdhurun. This is part of piety. Then you start with your washing of hand. You start with the prayer, the pious prayer. This Allahumma inni as'aluka al-yumna wal barakata wa a'udhu bika min ash-shubur. You say Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa as'aluka al-yumna wal barakata wa a'udhu bika min ash-shubur wal halkati. That's one. You print three times here. Then before you come to your mouth, to brush it and clean it, you say Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa khusn ibadatika. Then you do it three times. Then you go to your nose and you say Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa awjidni raihat al jannati wa anta anni radih. Then you do it three times. You do it, you take the water very carefully and sneeze it out on the left side because you are facing the Qibla. You do it three times. Then after that, you face the washing of the face. You say, Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin بيض وجهي بنورك يوم تبيض وجوه أوليائك نعوذ بك أن تسود وجهي يوم تسود وجوه أعدائك. Three times before you finish, there is no limit. Whether if you do it, if you feel every part of your face has been washed clearly and it has become clean, or twice, or three times, or four times, or five times, it's all the same. There is no limit in accordance with the Imam Malik radiallahu ta'ala and his teaching. He taught at the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then you take up to the hands. When you come to wash the hand completely here, you say, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin wa atini kitabi yamini wa hasibni hisaban yaseer. Give me my, on the day of judgment, give me my visa to Al-Janna on the right hand.
So alhamdulillah, we believe.
Then you come to the left and this is up to the time you finish, then you read.
So that is trying to tell us that a pious Muslim must learn to perform his ablution properly, because ablution, a key to Al-Jannah, from ablution,
a key to Salat is ablution,
and a key to Al-Jannah is Salat. So it is very important that a pious Muslim should know how to perform his ablution appropriately, and also to perform his Salat also appropriately. So a good Muslim should also perform, give out obligatory alms, should also read his Quran regularly, and many other things that he should do. So I want you to tell us more about the how piety can manifest many aspects.
Very good. Piety expresses itself as soon as a Muslim wakes up in the morning. He wakes up with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Knowing that he has no creator but Allah. He has no endower, the only person who endows him with everything is Allah. He has the Sharia before him. He should not offend or hurt or harm anybody, Muslim or non-Muslim, human beings or jinns or birds or animals, with his hand or with his mouth. That is Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He should not harm or hurt anybody, whether great or small, servant or slave. He knows him or he doesn't know him. That's it, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The final prophet of Allah sent for final guidance and as a general mercy for all creatures all over the universe, not only on this earth, which is just 25,000 miles in circumference, not that, the upper universe, the solar system, and the super galaxy, the cluster of galaxies, in the super galaxy of stars, beyond the Asma'u Dhatul Raja'ah, beyond, there is no astronomical name for these, beyond Asma'u Dhatul Khubuk, that is all the limits, the place where all these huge stars, one of them, as I can say, is about 20,000 millions bigger than the sun. Our sun is the sun you see every day, and this sun, which sends radiation and other things, electromagnetic waves and all those wonderful things there, is only 93 million miles away from us. There are other suns. That's why the Almighty is in other surah, surah, just immediately after Surah An-Nur. The Almighty says the bigger suns there, all of them in orbit. They're not running. It's the speed of in each one in its orbits. Not a million stars or a billion stars, but tens and thousands and billions of stars, each one on its orbit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been sent to all of us. Each particular summer, this is heaven or heavenly body has its own particular creation. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, living people, more intelligent than we are, the people here, for example, we have NASA. That is NASA, is National Aeronautics and Space Administration of the United States. They have spent millions or trillions or quadrillions of what is their money? This their money, not naira. This American dollars. Just trying to know whether there are people living there. There are other creations more intelligent than we are. One day, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, over 1,400 years ago, he came in from the house. He saw his companions, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, in the mosque, sitting carefully, silently. When he came, they paid attention to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He asked them, "Why do I see you silent?" They said, "We are thinking about the creation, the ayat of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala." Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, exactly, that is what you do. Think about his ayat.
Allah Akbar. That is among the duties of a pious Muslim.
Thinking about the ayat of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just be 1/2 minute, showed one direction. He said, "There's a land creation here, such and such miles from, such and such distance from the earth. And it is as white as linen. It is white, and its whiteness is like its luminosity. Its luminosity is like its whiteness. There are some people, some creations there, they have never committed any sin." Allah Akbar. The Sahaba asked him, Are they from the Bani Adam? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "No, they don't even know who is Adam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam." First they say, "Why is the Satan? Does he not go to them and cause them to do things?" He said, "They don't know who is the Satan. They are totally different. Far, 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 millions of miles into the heavens." Then they say, "Are this Bani Adam?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "They don't even know who is Adam." But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the old matter says that, "Wa ma arsalaka illa rahmatan
lil alamin,"
for the whole universe. And the universe is too great to be measured by miles or what is the highest, the longest of this is
longest of what?
Of the longest of the measurement of astronomers. Maybe astronomical unit, which is only 93 million miles, and the one of 6 billion miles, just they measure it with this. There are so many. Subhanallah. There are about, what can we say, it's just 700,000 million of such creations before you go to the first heaven, heaven one. Some years ago, the Students Union of the United States sent a letter to Kaduna, former Grand Cadi, saying that the BBC people have said that we should throw away about the seven heaven and the seven earths. Then they asked the Grand Cadi, the Honorable Grand Cadi, said, "Well, what would be?" He sent the letter to me, saying that I should give them. Then I just wrote 3 articles. It was printed in the Gaskat article, because the people, so the BBC spoke in Hausa, so I gave them answers, which shows that even today, it shows that the astronomers, I'm sorry to say, I'm not an astronomer, that I'm speaking Islamically. So far as the universe is concerned, the astronomers know almost nothing. It is just like a person who is going to Hajj and saying he has just gone to the airport, saying that he has gone to Hajj. It's just, this is even too small for that. Heaven one, One of the modern astronomers said that there is one star, it's NGC 147 or NGC 1. They give them different names, astronomers. I am not an astronomer, but I have read it and seen it. They say if people, if they're the astronomers, the engineers, the royalists, the emperors and so on, they say they want to send someone to one to the nearest star, just one of them, the NGC 147 or something like that. If they use all the materials on this earth, all the water on this earth that contains just DTO, that is deuterium oxide, which is the substance they use for hydrogen bombs. If they say they all use it. And they use photon engines, which is quicker than anything you can imagine. It travels at the speed of light. They say it will never reach that star. And all that is Asma of Zatul Hubuk. It is in the nearest. We haven't reached the Wasaqaf al-Marfu', that is the highest heaven from us, and not even heaven one. You see, the Prophet had been sent to all the creatures of us here. And the taqwa we shall do is to do it exactly as he has told us about evolution and then about the prayers. After we have finished our evolution, we raise our head to the heavens, not that because the Almighty is in heaven, no, he is with us, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And everywhere.
Everywhere. That's why.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Viewers, if you are just joining us, we are sitting on your program, Islam, the Way of Life, and the topic is the piety. Who are the pious Muslims?
Exactly.
So, and our father has been able to do that, justify it is still piety in Islam. So, as a Muslim, a pious Muslim, our father has been talking to us on how to be a pious Muslim. And here, he wants to remind us of many other points too. That is, if you are a Muslim, a good Muslim, and you are lucky to be in the same compound with a married couple, you should try your best to avoid any communication with their wives, that is your co-tenant's wife, their daughters, and their mothers, so that you don't transgress through them. And also, you should avoid lengthy talk with people, with them. So our father is going to talk more on those ones.
Very
like
good.
How do you supposed to treat the needies? As a Muslim, how are you supposed to treat the needies? Yeah. Are you supposed to watch them or?
No. The needy people, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has instructed us to do with them. It just as soon as you are aware, any Muslim, whether you know him or not, is in need. Just try to get something from your pocket or from inside the house, whether food or money, whether cash or food or anything that you think he is in need. You keep him, you take it carefully, you take him to a corner, you just dash him without anybody knowing about it. Without anybody knowing about it.
And also you should avoid buying and hoarding foodstuff.
Exactly.
With the unsocial hope of famine or death of
provisions,
when you can sell them at more than the usual price.
Exactly. It's when you see people are in dire need of food or other things, essential commodities. Never buy them in large quantities and hold them until people become in dire need for it, until when it is very, very dear.
And you must also avoid profiteering and smuggling.
Exactly.
Exactly. Like
smuggling.
This is unpatriotic and
unpatriotic. Exactly. It is against taqwa. It is against piety. Anything that will cause people to suffer, you will not do. You should not do it. Because if you do that, then why is the Prophet saying, "Al Muslim ahul Muslim la yadhlimuhu wa la yakhdhuluhu wa la yashtumuhu"? Then he say, "At taqwa ahula." You should keep your piety very, very alive. Never do anything or say anything that will harm your neighbor, Muslim or non-Muslim, harm him or harm her, hurt him or hurt her. You should live as brotherly as the sons of Adam and Eve, Nana, Hawa, and our father Adam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
and a Muslim should not, should guide against polytheism, that is adultery.
Exactly.
Also idolatry as well.
Exactly.
Can you explain that?
Yes. Adultery, when a person is married and commits adultery, that is terrible. That is terrible. If he had worshipped for even 70 years, like you, I guess, just now over 70, just over 72. If he commits adultery now, all the services he has rendered in his religious service have been destroyed.
Just like, for one commitment?
Just for one commitment.
Because all the worship?
All the worship, yes. Everything has been committed, destroyed. He has nothing. If he dies at that moment, he will have nothing on the day of judgment.
Allah Akbar.
Unless Allah Alam. But it is terrible. Because you see, just one, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, one ejaculation of just semen introduced into a womb which does not belong to you has at least 250,000 to 500,000 spermatozoa, living things. Each one will curse you. They will curse you. Only one is capable of impregnating, but they are living things. This curse will just destroy all your religious duties, all. Each one ejaculation contains at least 250,000 to 500,000 spermatozoa.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, we've listened to who the pious people are. They are ulaika Allahudan min rabbihim wa ulaika humul muflihun. They are the true guidance. They are the people that follow the true guidance from their Lord, and they are the successful. Allah make us among the successful
Ameen.
Muslims.
Ameen. Ameen.
So here we are going to round up for the day.